that look, we have all of these amazing technologies, everything from AI to digital medicine, sensors, robotics, quantum computing, and they're on exponential paths. If they're used for good, then we can reach Star Trek. We can achieve the amazing things that we dreamed about. If we use it for evil, then we're going to have Mad Max.
Thank you for joining Change I Am Possible, which is India's first future tech podcast, a humble effort to be a voice and a platform for those brave and disruptive entrepreneurs such as yourself who are building the future. So Mr. Vivek Wadhwa is an author, tech entrepreneur, a distinguished fellow, an adjunct professor at Carnegie Mellon School of Engineering, and a distinguished fellow at the Labor and Work-Life Program at Harvard Law School. So it's a really pleasure and honor to be talking to you face to face. So thank you, really appreciate doing this. So let's start with your recent book, which you wrote, From Incremental to Exponential. Well, what was the idea? What drove you to write the book, and what's the idea and the vision behind the book?
You know, this is the US version of the book. It's actually a follow-up to this book, Driving the Driverless Car.
Right.
And this is what I teach, students at, I've retired from Carnegie Mellon very recently, but this is what I've been teaching and teach business executives. Driving the Driverless Car teaches the basics of exponential technologies. You know, I know that you're trying very hard to educate people in India about it. Here in Silicon Valley, we talk about it quite a bit because, this is where we make it all happen. But a whole range of technologies now is making the impossible possible. Literally, you know, it's the stuff from science fiction is happening before our very eyes without us realizing it. But at the same time, technologies that can be used for good are being used for evil. I mean, social media, I mean, what we're doing right now is amazing. The fact that, you know, I'm talking to you from India and it's, we're used to this is like normal now. We talk to everyone. And this is right out of science fiction. If you saw the Jetsons, there was a 1960s TV series. I used to love it. But they had devices such as this. Star Trek had devices such as this, right? We have them now. We take it for granted. So this is the good of some of the technologies. On the other hand, look at what Facebook has done. Facebook started off being a force for good, to bring the world together and to facilitate connectivity, except it became a force for evil, because it started using the same technologies to separate and divide people. It was making so much money by polarizing people, by putting them into their own cocoons, into their own little filter bubbles, that it could get them to watch more and learn more about them and sell them more ads. So Mark Zuckerberg basically became Darth Vader, and he sold his soul and turned it into evil. So Facebook has been accused of impacting the US elections. The United Nations basically accused it of fermenting genocide of Muslim Rohingya refugees. In India, WhatsApp has been used to trigger violence. I mean, it's become a force for evil, right? So what this book, Driving the Driverless Car, tried to explain was that, look, we have all of these amazing technologies, everything from AI to digital medicine, sensors, robotics, quantum computing, and they're on exponential paths. If they're used for good, then we can reach Star Trek. We can achieve the amazing things that we dreamed about. If we use it for evil, then we're going to have Mad Max. So that's what that book was about. That's part one. So part two, so this is what I've been teaching. So my CEO friends, I know CEOs of many, many big companies all across the world, they started asking me for help, saying, okay, Vivek, you've scared the shit out of us. What do we do now? How do we now benefit from this and use it for good rather than evil? So I started teaching them about how exponential technologies converge and disrupt industries. So part one is what the core technologies are. And this is what your audience needs to understand, first of all, is learn the basics. I mean, you can get these books are available in India now. They're only 200 or 300 rupees. You can get them cheap in India. So they're affordable by all the people who are watching it. Learn the basics, first of all, what the technologies are and how to use them for good. Step two is now, how do you build trillion-dollar industries from these things? Because when technologies converge, you get incredible opportunities. You get the ability to create, billion-dollar companies, trillion-dollar industries. So, like self-driving cars, it isn't one technology that's making self-driving cars available. It's several. You have AI and sensors and robotics all coming together and making it possible. Digital medicine, I believe we can cure cancer now. It's not because of, anything happening in medicine. It's because, again, you have AI, you have sensors, you have genomics, you have synthetic biology all converging and making the impossible possible. So when you are looking at it from a business point of view, so you know the people who are watching this who want to be entrepreneurs, who want to build billion-dollar businesses, first of all, you know, don't focus on $1 billion, because you know that's the biggest mistake you can make, is to sell your soul like Zuckerberg did and focus only on making money. The way you become a billionaire is by helping a billion people. You know, if you have a genuine desire to use technology to uplift people, then you'll find that there are opportunities here to make money as well. There's nothing wrong with making money. There's nothing wrong with being a billionaire, provided you don't sell your soul, right? So now, if you understand how these convergences happen, how technologies come together and disrupt industries, you can start thinking about opportunities to solve big problems. That's what the Indian cover is different. The Indian cover has an elephant, and it's only like 300 or 400 rupees. I think on sale you can get for 300 rupees on Amazon and a bunch of other sites in India. But that's what the book teaches you. So that's mandatory reading for you know. And these books, I don't make money on them. I give everything away. I wrote them because I wanted to teach and inspire people like you and people like the people who like those who are watching this to do good for the world and to use technology in a sensible way. So that's what these books are.
Thank you. I mean, for pointing out here that I think we're living in an awesome time, and all of these technologies have a potential to fundamentally transform how we work, live, and play. So I'm super excited about all of these technologies, and some of them are like really converging, right from the autonomous vehicles to 5G to artificial intelligence to augmented reality, virtual reality, mixed reality. So I'm super, super excited. But yes, I mean, you pointed out that how Facebook and some other tech companies are using this super transformational technology for bad. So yes, we have the opportunity, because this right now is the time. If you understand and learn, there is so much that we can do. So yes, obviously, I'll put the link of the book and where it's available over here in India, so my audience can look at it and possibly buy the book. Whatever technologies that I spoke about, I mean, somehow it's been on a creeping mechanism, and people were not looking at it. But because of COVID, now suddenly there's a huge lens on all of these frontier technologies. So could you give some examples on how businesses and individuals could transform their lives if they adopt and adapt these technologies? And if you could also talk about exponential and what exactly it means, because people have heard the term, but they don't really fathom that what exponential is. Possibly we could talk about that and how technology, these future technologies, will create transformation in individuals and businesses.
Let's talk about COVID to start with. In India in particular, people were poo-pooing all of these reports, saying that, look, there are going to be millions of people infected and so on, because they didn't understand exponentials. What happens is that 1 becomes 2, becomes 4, becomes 8, becomes 16, becomes 32. Become 64, and before you know it, you have a billion, So this is exponentials. And the way the virus spread is exactly how exponential technologies advance, that the numbers catch up, it really take you by surprise, and we don't understand exponentials. I used to say that, when I gave talks all over the world, when I would give my talks, I would start off by explaining what exponential means. I would show these charts which show exponential advances and how it's advanced. Now, everyone is talking about exponentials. Grandma is talking to Junior about, flattening exponential curves, because we all saw it with COVID, right? We all saw how things take you by surprise and take you by shock. So that is exponential. That technology, the computing power of our, the computing power has been increasing exponentially for the past 100 years. This device I have in my hand, it's a Samsung smartphone, right? This has more computing power than probably 50 or 100 Cray supercomputers. You remember Cray supercomputers? Most of the people watching this are very young, but their parents know what Cray supercomputers are, because in India, you weren't allowed to import them. They cost right. $20 or $30 million, right, which was a big deal in those days. And the America would not allow you to export them to India. This thing here is more powerful than probably 100 Cray supercomputers. and you can carry it in your pocket and walk around, you know, take a flight to India and no one stops you. What's more, you can get phones in India, the Jio phones, which cost practically nothing, which are more powerful than 30 or 40 Cray supercomputers. The poorest of the poor have them. So, you know, that technology infected every other technology. Because of, you know, the exponential advances in computing, you started having exponential advances in every other field. That, you know, as Ray Kurzweil says, any technology that becomes information-based starts advancing exponentially. So genomics started advancing exponentially because the cost of sequencing has been dropping at an exponential or even faster than exponential rate. You know, the first genome was sequenced, the human genome was sequenced in the year 2000. This is the problem of these technologies, that they drive you crazy. They just go on and on and on. I wrote another book, by the way, about this. Okay, if you want to take another detour, this is also available in India. Your Happiness Was Hacked.
Right.
It talks about how technologies are taking over your lives.
Right.
So here I'm doing they take over your lives. Anyway, getting back on point. So genomics has been dropping, the cost of genomic sequencing has been dropping exponentially to the point that what cost $3 billion in the year 2000 to sequence the first human genome now can be done for about $400 or $500. Okay, move forward 5 years and it'll be as cheap as a cup of coffee at Starbucks, right? It'll cost practically nothing to do a complete human genome sequence. So getting back to COVID now. How did we get these vaccines so fast? You know, when this virus first started spreading, people were saying it'll take 30 years to come up with vaccines. Then it was 10 years, 5 years. And I went on national TV here in the United States and I said, look, I expect by the end of the year, we'll have multiple vaccines. People thought I was crazy. He's just a techie. What does he know about medicine? Well, we have multiple vaccines. How did it happen? That you use genetic sequencing and RNA-based technologies and synthetic biology to instantly come up with a method of attacking the virus. Now, the hard part was testing it. That's what took, you know, the majority of the time. But right. Coming up with a method of killing the coronavirus only took a few weeks. It's because of exponential technologies, right? So these advances are happening in every field you can think of. And the challenge is for all of you to learn these things. And that's why I started by saying, read my books, because there's no way I can, you know, talk you about all this, you know, on the internet. There's too much here. But every technology you think of, artificial intelligence, robotics, sensors, networks, all on exponential paths. And if you can understand the exponential curves, if you can just sort of look forward and say, okay, virtual reality is now very clunky. These VR headsets are still big and cumbersome. They're still expensive. They still cost $700. But if you think about it, this stuff is on the exponential curve. So which means within 3 or 4 or 5 years, you know, just like you and I wearing glasses, we'll have glasses that turn dark and take us into holographic worlds. And it won't be the crappy, you know, VR headsets you have right now, where it obviously looks like a 1970s TV, kind of color TV set. It'll be amazing. It'll be lifelike. It'll be like, you know, your 4K or 8K television sets all happening in front of you. If you think that within 3 or 4 or 5 years, VR is going to be like that, then suddenly you begin to realize that, you know, the core technologies for this don't exist. We don't have the education tools for this yet. We don't have this. We don't have that. Maybe I can start creating Bollywood movies in which I can be the hero. That when I'm doing a car chase, instead of, you know, watching it on a big screen, I can be in the driver's seat and I can be driving the car. Or maybe Deepa Padukone can be my girlfriend if I, you know, look like Shah Rukh Khan. I mean, I don't know. I mean, you know, we have some very smart people and horny men on this podcast. I'm sure they can come up with great ideas for what to do with these technologies. But the point is, and by the way, I don't want the horny men to dominate. I want the amazing women to use technology because they use it in a more sensible way. I wrote another book called Innovating Women, which I don't know if it's available in India or not, but you can get it online. Innovating Women talks about how women are going to own the future and how they're the key to building the Star Trek future. But regardless, if you start learning these technologies, you can now start predicting what's going to happen and take advantage of them. So if you know the cost of VR headsets is going to be down dramatically, you can start building the technology. You can start thinking about all the applications that other people haven't thought of. And while, you know, everyone, even the VCs, are a bunch of idiots, as far as I'm concerned. They want to invest in you because, you know, VR is still cumbersome and blah, 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 and all these stories they tell. You can look ahead of them, because you don't need VCs anymore to start companies. The cost of all of these things is so low that you can go to your cha-cha or your mama and ask them, you know, to lend you a few lakh rupees. And they'll probably do it if they get some equity in your firm, because they're also now looking to fund startups. And you can build your own, you know, virtual reality technologies. So look forward and expect that the technology will catch up with you if you, you know, understand its exponential progress. $1 trillion opportunities, $1 billion opportunities to build companies.
Right. You rightfully pointed out that, you know, I mean, the virtual reality as a technology is racing ahead. Just around four or five years back, when Oculus came out with the first headset, it was clunky, it was expensive. And a virtual reality headset with a computer was somewhere around $3,000.
$2,000 was the exactly. Base unit.
And right now, I think Oculus Quest, the price point has come down 10 times. It's retailing at $299. So yes, there's some awesome things happening. And yes, technology is being democratized, you know, as an entrepreneur, and especially entrepreneurs in Indians, India is jugadu, you know. I mean, we don't need to depend on, you know, these big VC players. You know, you can reach out to people who crowdsource, and people understand that, you know, that these technology is the future. So yes, there is so much opportunity over here. Now, COVID, again, I mean, I'll dwell on it a little bit, because it's been really, really disruptive. India's work force has been disrupted. The migrant labors have been disrupted. So we are in a bad space. The economy was down some 23.9%. It's recovering, but it still looks tough, because I think it's going to take maybe like a year or so for us to come back to normal. If you were part of the government, what would you advise the government? What would you implement for us to reverse the COVID impact?
Yeah, you know, as far as the Indian economy goes and so on, they have to open up the economy, you know, push all sorts of reforms through, which open up the economy, which boost entrepreneurship, which, you know, eliminate the bankruptcy laws, which protect labor, however, make it possible to hire people and then, you know, lay them off if your startup doesn't work. You go through all of the regulations and get rid of the British era laws and take India into a modern economy. And then basically, you know, the key is to empower entrepreneurs to do incredible things, fund startups. I mean, I'm a big fan of Amitabh Kant and Niti Aayog. I mean, those people are thinking the right way. I mean, they may make mistakes and, you know, mess up, you know, a few things here or there, but generally speaking, they seem to understand, you know, the technologies we're talking about, and they've been trying to boost entrepreneurship. We need much, much, much more of that. And we need entrepreneurs to come together and help each other. You know, ultimately, it's not the government who's going to make the difference. It's entrepreneurs coming together. This is how Silicon Valley, you know, the funny thing over here is that in Silicon Valley, Indians went from being beggars and snake charmers to being techies to now being CEOs of the hottest companies over a period of 30 or 40 years, right? Why? Because what did they do that differently than what's being done in India? They came together and started helping each other. You know, we formed different groups like the Indus Entrepreneurs. Indus ETIE is now becoming an elitist organization, so I don't recommend that you folks join TAI, but create your own networking organizations where you help each other. It was all a matter of Indians helping Indians. And voila, the magic happened. They started rising. They started achieving success. Now, you know, one in every seven startup here is founded by an Indian. And if you look at the CEOs, you know, separate discussion, I was sending emails to, I wanted to get some help with a cancer project in India. So I wanted to contact some of the large companies. It just occurred to me. So you have Arvind Krishna from IBM. You have Sundar Pichai from Google. Satya Nadella from Microsoft, all a bunch of Indians over here, right? Leading the most amazing companies. Well, if they can do it here, they can do it in India. And the difference between here and India was that we came together and started helping each other, that we realized that there are opportunities here. And the only way we're going to win is by mentoring each other and learning from each other. That's what you need to do on a larger scale. So form your own networking groups and just selflessly help each other. Because what you'll find is that by teaching others, you gain. I mean, why do I write so much? Why do I speak so much? Because by, you know, teaching you, by giving, you gain, okay? The more you give, the more you gain. By sharing knowledge, the knowledge multiplies and you become smarter. So this is what happens when you mentor others, that you, you know, you, your knowledge is 1 + 1 = 3, that you have an idea, they have an idea, and suddenly, you know, new ideas form. So you become smarter and the person you're mentoring becomes smarter. So mentor others. All of you have specific skills. Some of you might be A+ coders in, you know, Java. Others might be in Python. Others may be great marketing people. You may have some people who are musicians and artists. You know, people may be dancers. I mean, everyone has a different skill. Well, when you put all of these skills together, the magic happens, that you can now come together and start forming billion-dollar companies and solving trillion-dollar problems.
Technology is growing in a way that there is one part of me is extremely excited that, oh, wow, this is what technology can do. In another few years, it can create some huge transformation. But then there's this other part of me, which is also getting scared, because all of these technology can potentially transform mankind, you know. So because if you see, like, you know, even just if you take one technology, say you look at artificial intelligence, you know, we have GPT-3, which is doing pretty decent natural language processing. There is MooZero, where you don't even have to give it the rules, but it plays the game. There's AlphaFold, which is solved the protein folding problem. But now all of these technologies are not even mature. They are in a very narrow space. There is virtual reality, which is...
Why do you think I wrote this book? I mean, this book is all about my fears. I mean, I call myself Dr. Jekyll and Mr. Hyde, because I'm like you over here, that excited one day, terrified the next day, good one day, evil the next day. You know, even this coronavirus, I actually think it was a lab accident. I mean, this is a sound like a weird theory, but I think that the Chinese were doing experimentation with gain-of-function research in the labs, synthetic biology, and it leaked out of the lab, and that's what created this pandemic. Okay, so I'm not trying to be conspiracy theorist over here, but that's because I see the dark side of technology. I know how technology can be used for evil, and I worry about it. On the other hand, I was telling you very, very excitedly about how, you know, with synthetic biology, with microRNA and genetic sequencing, we're able to, you know, now come up with vaccines for the coronavirus. It's good and it's evil at the same time. You're right that we need to be fearful. I'm glad you're fearful, because you're like me. One day I'm very excited and optimistic about the future. The next day I'm terrified, I'm fearful. I mean, Mark Zuckerberg, you know, lives a few, living in Menlo Park and, you know, Palo Alto. So all of these people are locals. Mark Zuckerberg nearly ran me over once when I was in downtown Palo Alto. And, you know, you bump into people all the time. I used to think the world of Mark Zuckerberg. I would say amazing. I would say that he's an amazing guy. I would say very good things about Zuckerberg until he turned into Darth Vader, until he turned evil. Right. So it's good and evil at the same time. That's the way it is, my friend. And this is why I'm spending time talking to you, because I'm hoping that these people are more likely to do good than evil, and they'll use technology in a smart way to solve problems.
Today, I mean, the biggest problem is inequality. You know, I mean, there is it's almost sucking us, you know, completely. So do you think that technology will play a role in creating an equitable future? You know, because there is blockchain, which says that we can, create a decentralized government.
The fact is that there are many, 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 you know, technologies advancing, and the cost of everything is dropping. So the next 5 years or so, we're going to be 3D printing meat. Now, let me ask you a question over here. You know, do you eat beef or do you not eat beef? Okay, so you don't eat meat at all, right?
Yeah.
A lot of people in India won't eat beef or pork because of religious reasons.
Right.
And also, and people like you, you might be worried about killing animals, okay? The cruelty involved in killing animals. Well, what if you could synthetically produce meat? What if you could, you know, just like with 3D print, I mean, you know, 3D print plastic and toys and so on, we could 3D print food. And instead of being acquired from an animal, we simply created a synthetic sequence of the next, you know, chicken or the next beef or the next pork, which had all the nice qualities without having the, you know, the bad qualities of it. And there was never an animal that was touched over here. All you're doing is synthetically producing protein. Would you eat it? Now, what do you mean, veg or non-veg? It's not even veg, because we could be synthetically producing veg as well. So it's not veg. No, it's not veg or non-veg. It's synthetic, right? And it's very healthy protein. 5 years from now, that becomes possible. Will you eat it? I mean, you don't have to think about it, but the point is, well, the Hindus eat beef when it's not really beef. It just happens to be called, you know, sin beef or whatever it might be called. I mean, but it's not beef. It's simply synthetically produced. And it has all the nutritional value. It has, you know, it does the good things in that. But those are the two. And 5 years from now, the cost is comparable to to meat that you buy from the supermarket. 10 years from now, it costs a tenth as much because the cost keeps dropping. So now we have the ability, and then with vertical farms, we are able to now grow all the healthy organic food we want in the heart of New Delhi or Bangalore. You know, these empty buildings you have, you set up a synthetic farm there, and you can grow all the food you want to. So the cost of food drops exponentially. So we can feed everyone. Housing. I mean, homelessness. It's sad to see people on the streets. Not only in India, but even in Palo Alto. I mean, you go down to downtown Palo Alto, you have homeless people. It's disgusting that we have so much inequity and poverty, even in the richest countries in the world. But what if we could now simply, you know, we have all sorts of empty land everywhere. What if we could simply 3D print buildings for them, 3D print, you know, mansions for them, and the cost of 3D printing was a hundredth of what it is right now. 10 years from now, you know, it won't be 100, it'll probably be a tenth of what it is right now. But the point is that all of this becomes possible. We now develop the ability to have unlimited food for everyone, unlimited clean energy. Energy is still expensive, but if you look at the trend, I mean, read my last foreign policy article. If you go to wadhwa.com, but I wrote a piece about how we've now crossed the threshold, and maybe provide a link to it. Right. But read the article that you talked about now transitioning to clean energy, that the era of new clean energy is here. Renewable energy is now going to dominate the future. And the cost of it is going to be about one quarter of what it is today by the end of this decade, which means that solar energy will be pervasive everywhere. Electric vehicles will be pervasive, and they'll cost a fraction of what they do today. So the poorest of the poor can now have education. They can afford electric vehicles. They can afford 3D houses because the cost has dropped so much, and we can gift it to them. This happens in the next 10 or 20 years or so. So right. We can solve the problems of inequality. But the question is, will we?
Right.
I don't know. Because the rich are getting richer. The poor are getting poorer. I mean, and the social unrest. So these are the choices we have to make. And this is, again, what driving the driverless car was about. That's why I wrote the book, pleading with people to say, start learning these things and start using technology for good. Because if we don't, we're now going to destroy ourselves. We're going to have Mad Max dystopia, rather than Star Trek.
It's in our hands to chart the course of a future, you know, because we have these tools, you know, in the form of technology, which is so transformational. You know, you spoke about cultured meat. There are startups in India who are making synthetic egg and even meat and clean energy. I think that's the basic. But India, I mean, you know, Delhi, Bombay, Bangalore, it's super, super polluted, you know, and we need bold entrepreneurs. And I mean, Elon Musk has recently invested or donated $100 million to pull carbon out of air. So there are some exciting things happening. And I hope that this technology, which you've been stressing on, that people start using technology for a good. The country America has moved from Mr. Donald Trump to the new president, John Biden and Kamala Harris. So what are you most excited for Joe Biden and Kamala Harris taking office, and what policies are you looking forward to?
I mean, Joe Biden is committed to clean energy. I'm a strong proponent of clean energy because we need to save the planet. Kamala Harris and Joe Biden are going to be strong proponents of skilled immigration. That, even though for India, it's good if everyone, all the skilled immigrants come back home over here. But I'm looking at it from an American that I want to keep the best and the brightest over here. So they're supporting that, right? I mean, so there's a lot more civil discourse. Donald Trump was doing some things good. Okay? It wasn't, all bad. But the trouble is that he was polarizing. He was really, causing America to be ripped apart rather than bringing it together. So there was a lot of damage that he did. These people will undo some of that damage. But on the other hand, Donald Trump was doing some things right as well. I'm hoping that they'll keep those things there. For example, he was very tough on China, right? He wouldn't take any BS from them. But I hope that they follow his policies. So it's good and bad. You know, governments come and go, and very often very little changes because that's just the way the system works. Regardless of what governments do, it's entrepreneurs who have to save the world. It's really, us who have to make the difference in the world.
Right. So what would be your advice to Indian entrepreneurs and students listening to the podcast?
That anything that can be done here can be done in India now. There is no advantage to being in Silicon Valley or being in America. All the tools and technologies that I teach, that I talk about, are available in India and they're affordable. There's nothing you can't do. There's nothing, no reason why you can't be building spaceships to go to the moon. I mean, you know, you do have a couple of amazing Indian startups that have been building lunar landers and stuff like that, right? So I'm a big fan of, of these companies. But the point is that you can do it all there. There's nothing stopping you. All the knowledge is available online. All the tools and technologies are available online. You can order anything you want on the web. So nothing's stopping you. And it doesn't cost billions of dollars to build billion-dollar companies anymore. Like I said, you can go to your cha-cha and your mama and get the money you need to do your startup there.
Right. Would you like to share any predictions for India for 2021 and beyond?
I mean, I've been saying for a long time that I'm very optimistic. If you go back and read my articles from 5 or 10 years ago about how India is going to have many billion-dollar companies, people were laughing at me, especially Indians. They thought, what does this idiot know about India? Go and read my articles. I was talking about the tech boom and how India is going to be solving, you know, big problems and so on and so on. And I've been right on that. So again, you know, I believe that entrepreneurs in India are going to make a big impact on humanity. That I'm also looking to cure cancer. I lost my wife to cancer and I came up with a grand plan to cure cancer. And I presented it to Narendra Modi and the Dalai Lama. Instead, some entrepreneurs over there and some scientists came together and they're launching a massive project which could lead to a cure for cancer. That project could not be done in America. It's being done. Maybe in a follow-up segment a couple of months from now, we'll talk about curing cancer. Once it gets further, do a follow-up on how India is going to cure cancer. And what am I talking about? Curing cancer? The whole world has been trying. America has spent hundreds of billions of dollars on this. I believe India can do this. If India can cure cancer, imagine what else it can do, right? This is the message to all of you, is there's nothing stopping you. You have an important role to play in innovation and you can save the world. Don't rely upon Elon Musk and these others. Elon Musk doesn't care about India. He's in his own world. He consumes too much drugs and he lives in his own secluded world. I love the guy, but I also know Elon's faults. I mean, I've known him for a long, long time. You don't need Elon Musk to come and save India. You can build your own. You can have your own Elon Musk, and hopefully they won't have his bad habits.
Right. Wish you the very best, Vivek, and thank you. It was a pleasure talking to you. And I think, you know, what a profound note to end on, you know, that, yes, I think we can have our own Elon Musk, you know, and we in India can have these big companies which creates a huge impact. And those big companies, not like, unlike Facebook, you know, I mean, who can actually go out and create businesses which, like you said in the beginning of the conversation, that creates an impact and touches lives of billions of people. And we have the opportunity over here.
Exactly. Look at, you know, the stories of Rahul Narayan, who you know, built the space startup I was talking about, and Sridhar Vembu, who, you know, built Zoho. Okay,
right.
Sridhar basically did it without any venture capital. You know, I've known, you know, he used to be in Palo Alto also, and he was telling me about his plans. He's going to do all without venture capital, and he did it. I mean, look at what he's achieved. You know, so this is what Indian entrepreneurs, what they can do.
Right. Yeah. And I think, you know, we're living in exceptional times, and I think there's nothing which is stopping us except for our will. And if you have the will, desire, and intent, the world is there giving you all the opportunity, the technology tool, everything is over there. Thank you once again for being part of Change App Possible podcast. And to my listeners, if you like what you see in India, please press the subscribe button. Until next time, see you guys. Bye-bye. Thank you. Thank you. I really appreciate this. Yeah. Thank you.
Take care.